I brought this so that I'd know what, actually, so I'd know what day it was. I'm not worried about the time. So I hate to have you miss the picnic, though. And if you weren't nervous before, Dave said I got a spare battery. So we'll try not to go too long. As we've been praying for Josh to get over this rash or this itch, they called up another guy with an itch. I got an itch to teach. Is that all right? Yeah. Well, let's welcome the Lord. Heavenly Father, we thank you. We've been worshiping. But Lord, you, by your Spirit, are our teacher. And he reveals the things to us that he receives from you. And Father, we ask you for eyes to see this morning, ears to hear, and a heart to understand. And we ask this all in Yeshua's name. Amen and amen. Welcome to 9/11, 2016 version. And we do remember all those lives that were lost and all the changes and adjustments that have happened in our country. And I'm not going to go too far into that, but we need to be careful. I've seen some things online. I was going to look up one of the Facebook things speaking about us coming together and we'll overcome anything. Need to go up? Can you not hear? Can you turn the volume just a smidgen? Thank you. Our only hope in these days to come is the Lord. We can unite together, but there's been nation after nation after nation that have united and they've fallen and they no longer exist. So the difference is this nation was established on the Lord, on the Lord Jesus Christ. And when we get away from that, nothing else really matters. It doesn't matter how many bombs we have or how politically correct we are, we need the Lord. And we need to remember that, and that's why you're here. I want to welcome you to the eighth day of Elul, which is the sixth month on God's calendar. You say, well, what does that mean? Well, last week was the first day of Elul. And on the first day of Elul, it was an interesting thing because the enemy doesn't want us to know God's calendar. You can look this up later, but in Daniel, the seventh chapter, verse 25, he talks about the Antichrist, the spirit of the Antichrist. And he talks about that it would be his desire to change the times and the seasons. And I want you to know that for most of the world and most Christians for most of their life, he's accomplished that. Because we're running on the wrong calendar. And because of that, we don't understand God's timetable. Do you understand that God, nothing happens by chance with God. And there's things that he wants to do. There's things he's going to do. And there's times, specific times, he wants to speak and teach us different things. And if we don't understand his way and his calendar of what he's doing, then these things will come and go and we'll say, what was that? In fact, we're very familiar that on the day of Pentecost, in the book of Acts chapter 2, there were how many people waiting in the upper room? There were 120. Jesus had risen from the dead. He descended back up into heaven. He'd showed himself for 40 days after the resurrection. And then just a mere 10 days after that period of time, after he ascends back into heaven, he tells them to wait in Jerusalem. But he had revealed himself, the scripture says, to over 500 people. And yet how many did we find in the upper room waiting? We find 120. Can you imagine that? The resurrected Lord appears to you and you see him with your own two eyes and realize this is true, but a mere 10 days later, three out of four are too busy. And it wasn't something, well, we didn't know what day it would be. God sent down his Holy Spirit on the day of Pentecost, or the Hebrew word for that is Shavuot. And God does things exactly on a timetable. Exactly on a timetable. There's a scripture that I want to read to you, and I'm going to jump back into where I just was. But there's a scripture here that I really felt this morning. Go with me, if you would, to Exodus chapter 34. And we're going to read about three verses here in the 34th chapter of Exodus. And I'm going to jump back into this topic or what's going on here that is kind of the heart of the message. But there's a couple verses here that I think we really need to understand this morning. And it says this, beginning in verse 5. Now, this is when Moses had gone back up the mountain the second time. And when he's up there, it says the Lord descended in a cloud, Exodus 34:5. The Lord descended in the cloud and stood there with him as he called upon the name of the Lord. Then the Lord passed in front of him and proclaimed. Now this is the Lord proclaiming about himself. The Lord God, compassionate and gracious. Does God lie? So he said, I'm compassionate and I'm gracious. Is that the God that most of the world has spoken about? We've got a false God out there that many of our Islamic brothers, they believe in Allah, and he's not a compassionate and gracious God. In fact, he says he's not a father, he has no son, and Muhammad's the true prophet. Well, all of those statements are wrong. Now, are these people terrible people? There are some that are. There are some Christians that are very terrible people who call themselves Christians. It's because they are believing a lie, just like a lot of people on the other side are. But it's time that we spoke the truth because we're in the end days, and we need to speak the truth. But the Lord says that he's compassionate and he's gracious and he's slow to anger. Some of us could take a lesson on that, huh? Slow to anger and abounding in loving kindness and truth. Is God going to lie to you? It's not in him. It's not who he is. He doesn't lie. Abounding in truth. And this is our Heavenly Father. This is the image of who we're to become. It says, who keeps loving kindness for thousands and forgives iniquity, transgressions, and sin. He forgives. Do you have iniquity, transgressions, and sins, things the enemy keeps pounding you with? God says that he forgives. He forgives those things. And then he goes on and he says this. The last part of this, he says this. Yet, in spite of him being so loving and compassionate and forgiving all of these things, he says, yet he will by no means leave. Now, we have written in our Bibles probably the guilty, but that's man adding that. He says, he will by no means leave unpunished, visiting the iniquities of the fathers on the children, on the grandchildren, to the third and the fourth generation. Why? Why would God want to say something? That sounds totally opposite of what he just said. But he's saying that these things, those that are guilty, there will be a punishment. And guess what? You and I could not afford the consequences because I, for one, I'm guilty. That's speaking about me. And that's why Jesus Christ came. And that's why Jesus Christ had to come. Because he paid the price. God would not allow the guilt to go by without it being punished. And either Jesus Christ has paid the price for your sins and transgressions, or you will. And that price will cost you eternity. And the most foolish thing that a person can ever do is choose to neglect such a compassionate and gracious God that says, these things are wrong, I will punish the guilty. And then he stepped down and he stepped into an earth suit and he said, I'll take the punishment for my children. And that only applies if you and I will accept what he's done. And most of the Christian church world understands that concept. And we're going to go through, I'm going to talk a little bit more about the feast. And the reason I want to talk about the feast is because we are coming in to probably the highest holy time according to not man's calendar, but God's calendar. Yes. See, man's got its own holy times. It's set up two golden calves just like Jeroboam did with Israel. I won't go into all those details. But Christianity has its high holy times, but they're not God's. And we're going to get into that just a little bit. And the title of this morning, if you want a title back there for the thing, it's called Prepare Yourself an Ark. All right? So back up here just a few chapters, and we're going to go to Exodus chapter 23. And I want to begin with verse 14. And we talked about man's calendar versus God's calendar. God has divine times and appointments. And most Christians don't have a clue about hardly any of them at all. We'll use the name Passover, but then to most Christians, Passover becomes Good Friday, of which it was not and is not. And sometimes Passover will correspond with a Friday during that Good Friday during that time, but God never set up Good Friday. God never set up Easter. He set up something called First Fruits. God set up a feast called Unleavened Bread that goes through that week when all those things are happening. But see, the enemy, and Daniel prophesied this. Remember the story, Daniel's in Babylon, and God, you know, he's highly esteemed by God, and he's pressing, and he's looking for answers, and you know, he's fasting, and then after 21 days of this fast that he's on, you know, the angel comes down with this message, and he says, your prayer was answered the first day, but he spent all this time fighting through the demonic interference in the heavenlies to get the message down to him. And he shows him many different things. But one of those things is what I spoke about earlier, is that the spirit of Antichrist, and the Lord showed him these earthly kingdoms of man coming together like a globalism, like a, you know, a one-man world or a one-world government. That's kind of where the world's running to right now. Well, he showed them all of those things, and he showed him what was behind the spirit of Antichrist. He showed him the world powers that had been controlled by that Antichrist spirit. But then he showed him what he was going to do. And he says this. He says this final kingdom, the one that's being formed even now as you and I live and breathe, this kingdom that the spirit of Antichrist, John said, even began back then. But this Antichrist, the person that everybody's looking for, they need to understand that the spirit behind that is Satan. And he's been manipulating man from day one. And he's been building up powers. But he gives Daniel this list of all the powers that have been and the ones that will come and the final one. And he says that the spirit, that its purpose is to change the times and the seasons that have been appointed by God. I'm paraphrasing, but that's what he's done. And he did an exceptional job doing that, because by the third and fourth century, we've got much of the foundation of the church system that we know, but that foundation began to be corrupted, and it was manipulated, it was twisted. In fact, there were laws that were made that by the third and the fourth century, that it's punishable by death if you celebrate Passover. You will celebrate Easter, but you will not celebrate Passover. And they separated themselves from everything that had to do with the Jewish part. And God had called the Jewish people to be caretakers of the word and the ordinances and the principles of God. And it's interesting, these principles and these ordinances of God, they were foreshadows of something much greater. But they were like, my understanding, they're like kindergarten lessons, but they're showing dates and appointments and different things. And the people who carried these things, most of them didn't have a clue as to what the full reality of what these things meant. In fact, you know, we speak of these feasts, and we're going to read this right here. Let me read this, and then I'll go to Madeline again. We're in Exodus chapter 23, and we're going to start in verse 14. He says, 3 times a year, you shall celebrate a feast to me. You shall observe the feast of unleavened bread for 7 days, and you're to eat unleavened bread as I've commanded you at the appointed time in the month of what? Now, my translation says Abib, A-B-I-B. The correct Hebrew on that is Aviv, A-V as in victor, I-V. But if you look in the Hebrew on that, it doesn't say in the month of Aviv. It says in the month of the Aviv. It says Ha-Aviv. And the reason it says the Aviv is because Aviv speaks of the ripening of the barley harvest. He's saying in the month of the ripening of the barley harvest, this is when this feast is. All right? And this is one of the only three months out of the year that God actually gives a name to. I said this was the sixth month. According to God's word, this month is called the sixth month. According to a little mixture of man, it's called Elul. And Elul was a name that was picked up when the children of Israel went into Babylon. It comes from a Babylonian name, all right? So there's only 3 months that actually have a name. It's the first month, the seventh month, and the eighth month. The first is, as you saw, Aviv. The seventh month is the month of Nathanim. I think I have it right. And the eighth month, that one I got to look back. I need to keep, I keep, Nathanim? Ethanim, not Nathan, Ethan, like Ethan Allen, but with an I-M on the end of it. And it's interesting, before I forget, that name Ethanim, it means permanent flowing waters. Amen. Didn't Jesus say that rivers of living water would flow from your belly? And we may get in, if I don't meddle too much, we might get a little deeper into that as we come to that. But the reason it's so important this month of Elul, the sixth month on God's calendar, is an important month because it's a countdown. And we're going to talk about what that countdown is all about, all right? Let me finish this part about this about the Feast of Unleavened Bread. So in the month of the Aviv, for in it you came out of Egypt, and none shall appear before me empty-handed. Now, he throws that down and says, well, this Feast of Unleavened Bread, what he's not telling you is God is grouped. He actually has seven specific feasts or holidays, if you want to use that word. They're grouped into three groups. The first group is called the Feast of Unleavened Bread. It begins with Passover, which we know is the day that Jesus was slain on the cross. And then that happens, and then the very next day after Christ was slain begins the first day of the Feast of Unleavened Bread that runs for 7 days. During that seven-day cycle, there will be a first day of the week. And that first day of the week is the day after the Sabbath or the day after the seventh day. That is called first fruits. And the shadow that they were given is they were told that when they enter the land, they were to take the first fruits of their harvest. And by the way, this month of Aviv that this comes in is speaking of the barley harvest being mature. It's a picture of Ruth and Naomi when they came back to Bethlehem. It was during the month of Aviv. It was during the barley harvest. It was at the time of Passover. That was at the time where we find Boaz and all this stuff going on. There's so much, so rich in here, the scripture, what God's showing them. But in that month, we find the first fruits. And the first fruits, they would bring up their crops before they would eat any of the barley. They would take a sheath of that, and they bring it to the priest, and the priest would do a wave offering. But he would do this on the first day of the week, the day following the Sabbath, during that Feast of Unleavened Bread. Now, it could be a Monday, too. It could be any one of the days that we've called. Do you understand that God only had one name for the 7 days of the week? There was the first day of the week, there was the second day of the week, there was the third day of the week, there was the fourth day of the week, there was the fifth day of the week, there was the sixth day of the week, and there was the Sabbath. All the other days are something man has added. Like Sunday, where do you think that one came from? The worship of the sun god. It comes from Baal worship. You know, Saturday from Saturn. There's so many different things in there. But anyways, so on this day of first fruits, Jesus came and he fulfilled that. Now, the Jews had been slaughtering lambs on Passover for 1,500 years before Jesus ever showed up. The first Passover we find during the time of the Exodus. And we find that, I'm sure that most of you are very aware of that, but we find it during the Exodus. And during that time was the time of the 10th plague, or the death of the firstborn. And that's where God gave them the shadow of what this was all about, that they were to take the lamb and they were to sacrifice it and put the blood on the doorposts of their home, and they were to remain in there that night. And the death angel, when he saw the blood, would pass over. And that was a picture, a foreshadow, if you will, of the Lamb of God, as John the Baptist said about Jesus, "Behold the Lamb of God that taketh away the sin of the world." You know the story very well. Most of the church world understands the Lamb of God that takes away the sin of the world. They understand that. It's preached up and down most Sundays, every place. They understand that. Now, what has happened is man has come in and he's added his traditions. He's changed the seasons and he's set up false priests. He's set up false feasts. And we can see the example in the Old Testament in the Bible, what happened to Israel. But the same thing has happened to us Gentiles. We've set up false priests, we have false priests, and we're missing what God has told us to do. So the early church outlawed Passover. You were not allowed to celebrate Passover, and all of a sudden Passover became Good Friday. I won't go into all those details. And then the celebration of the Feast of Unleavened Bread. See, unleavened is mean no leaven, no mixture. So he's saying if you're going to come back to me, you've got to get rid of the mixture. So for this whole week, they were to eat only bread without leaven, and they were to remove all foods that had leaven in them from their homes. They were to remove every trace of leaven out of their house. And it says if they didn't, and I can't give you the exact verse off the top of my head, but if they didn't, they would be cut off from Israel, from God's body. Now, you think, boy, that's pretty harsh. Well, what he's saying is if we don't get rid of the mixture that man has placed into the truth, into the Word of God, it will cost you your salvation. Do you understand? See, and who's behind the mixture? Satan is. Jesus talked about, he talked about the tares and the wheat. And he said that the good farmer, he planted good seed, but his servants come to him and he said, hey, we've seen these tares that are growing up. And he said, well, you know, basically, where'd that come from? It says, while they were sleeping, the enemy came in and he sowed tares among the wheat. Do you understand? That's mixture. And it's happened in our Jewish brothers and sisters. It's happened tremendously in the Gentile church. And guess what? We like our mixture. We like it. But God is warning us if we don't deal with the mixture, we're never going to be able to grow up in the things of God. And the enemy will bounce us back and forth with every wind of doctrine because we don't know what the Word of God means. So is it by any chance this Feast of Unleavened Bread begins the three times out of the year? It's the beginning. The beginning has to be where you determine in your heart, God, take the mixture out of me. I love you. I want to serve you. But I got so much junk in there. I don't even know what's junk and what's not junk. God says, I do. And this is a season, the first one of the year. All the males were to come. They were required to come to Jerusalem and to celebrate this Feast of Passover. Jesus was buried on the Feast of Unleavened Bread. He was crucified on Passover. And the sad thing was, most of the world didn't have a clue what was going on. In fact, even his disciples did not understand while he was being crucified that that was the Lamb that takes away the sin of the world. Even though John the Baptist had prophesied it and spoken it, they didn't understand that what he was doing was being sacrificed as the Lamb that takes away the sin of the world. It didn't come till later. And then Jesus was put into the ground the very next day, on Wednesday, not on Friday night. He was placed in the ground Wednesday afternoon before sundown. And he rose from the dead. There's how we get our three full days. The first day of the week begins at sundown on Saturday. I won't go through and count all those. But Jesus rose from the dead on first fruits. He was the first fruits of the resurrection, but he was also the first fruits of what God was planning upon the earth. Jesus said that it's needful that he die. Unless a seed dies and is buried, it stands alone. But if it dies and is buried, it produces what? Much fruit. And when you plant a seed, what kind of crop do you get from the seed? Whatever you planted. And Jesus was planted holy and righteous. So what kind of crop is God looking for? And they don't become, if you plant a kernel of corn, you don't grow a crop that's second quality corn. You grow a crop exactly in the genetic structure of what was planted. Do you understand the picture there? So this is to encourage you that Jesus wasn't a one and only. He was an only begotten because of how he came to the earth. But you know, Jesus was born righteous. Do you know how you become righteous? Not by being adopted into the family of God. There is no one that is adopted into the family of God. And if you've ever thought that, somebody's taught that, it's they don't understand the scripture, because adoption in the Bible is not the adoption that we understand. You don't come into the family of God unless you're born again. You were birthed into the kingdom the same way the Lord was birthed. And as he was birthed, free of the slavery of sin, when you're born again, guess what? You're set free from the slavery. No different than the example that was given to them when the children of Israel on Passover, And when they left there, the very next morning, they packed up, and 2+ million people marched out of Egypt after being there 430 years. That was on the day of the Feast of Unleavened Bread they left. The very first day of that. And there's so many examples in there. They're early types and shadows, but we need to understand that. And as I was saying, many people didn't see, they didn't understand, the disciples didn't understand that these feasts that they've been celebrating for 1,500 years was being fulfilled literally before their eyes. They didn't understand it. Now, you can go to any church, as I said, and you can hear about the Lord being raised from the dead, but in most churches, we'll do it at Easter, which is a heathen holiday. And it's a heathen holiday because it's mixture. And it comes from the word Ishtar, and it comes from Baal worship, and it's set up that holiday. Easter has nothing to do with Passover. It hits somewhere in the same time of the year, but it has everything to do when they would celebrate the holidays in Baal worship. And this was mingled in about 312 AD in that period of time. And all those things happened. So we've seen Easter. That's everything we knew about the Lord. But I'm telling you, it's about Passover, not Easter. And that's why when they first put it in, they made it punishable by death if you celebrated Passover. You were required to celebrate Easter. Why would you have to make something punishable by death? Because that's not what the people were doing, and they had to scare the bejeebers out of the people that weren't willing to go along with the lie that they were telling. And that's what happened in the early church. And that's the mixture. And there's mixture in the Gentile church. And dear Lord, there's mixture in the Jewish church. Because when they went to Babylon, they brought Babylon back with them. And we set up the rabbinic. We set up all sorts of things. We set up false dates and all kinds of things had gone on. So they need to come out of their mess as much as we need to come out of our mess. And as we come out of that mess, then the two of us can form the one new man. And that must happen in this generation if we're going to cross over and do the things God wants us to do. All right? So let's read the next feast here. It goes on. It says this. We're still in the 23rd chapter of Exodus. And it says in verse 16, and the next one is, you shall also observe the feast of harvest of the first fruits of your labors that you sow in the field. Now, it's a real short statement that he speaks to them, but what's this feast of harvest? It's called Shavuot. We know it as Pentecost, which comes 50 days after first fruits. Whenever first fruits hits that year, you can count 50 days and you find Shavuot. And if you follow the story, when the first Passover, and then the next day was the first day of this 7-day cycle of the Feast of Unleavened Bread, the Israelites left Egypt and they began a journey. And their journey took them across the Sinai Peninsula. All right? And we hear about the parting of the Red Sea, and I've talked about this before. It wasn't the Suez Canal side of that peninsula that they crossed the Red Sea. It was on the other side called the Gulf of Aqaba. And it was the gulf that goes between the Sinai Peninsula and Saudi Arabia. And they made their way over there. And what we find is that they crossed over. I'm not going to go into all that story. There's all sorts of scientific facts that can prove that they crossed there and not the other place. They didn't wander around in the Sinai Peninsula for 40 years. They were on the other side of the Gulf of Aqaba. They were wandering around in what today we know as Saudi Arabia. So by the time they get over there, they come to the Mount of God. And by the way, remember the story of Moses? Who was his father-in-law? And what was Jethro? He was a Midianite. And you can look on maps today, and they'll show you the land of Midian being right on the left side of Saudi Arabia, not the Sinai Peninsula. So he came from the land of Midian, remember? He came from the land of Midian, and when he went to follow that lamb, and he ends up seeing the burning bush, he was up on the mountain of God. He was up on Mount Sinai. And God said that he would bring the people back to that place. And that's exactly where he brought them, was back to the land of Midian, where the mountain of God was. You can look on, I think it's Google Earth, where you can zoom down and see actual photographs of anywhere. You can see your house. You can see your driveway. You can see whose car was parked in your driveway the day they took the picture. You can do the same thing for Mount Sinai. you can see where they cross. You can see the big sand delta that's on the other side of that Gulf of Aqaba over on the Sinai Peninsula. You can see that area, the only area that was big enough to support 2 to 3 million people plus all their flocks. And if you get the right picture, you can see the water of the Gulf of Aqaba, and you can see that it goes down hundreds and hundreds of feet deep on both sides, but there happens to be a land bridge underwater that's not that deep, that's mostly sand. And it goes across right from there to Saudi Arabia, the only place that anyone could possibly have crossed that. Even if God had moved all of the water out, if there hadn't been that land bridge, you can't carry cattle and things down 800, 900, 1,000 feet and come back up the other side 800, 900, 1,000 feet. It's too steep. There's no way they would have made it. So if you look at that, and these are things that no one knew until technology came, where they can take pictures from the sky, from satellites, and you can actually see the land bridge through the water. I mean, it's amazing when you see that. There's been studies, they found coral fixtures with wagon wheels and axles. In fact, there was a group of people during that time when the, was it the 74 war where the Jewish people, where they had the Sinai Peninsula for a while and then they gave it back to Egypt? Well, during that time, they did excavations in there, and one of the things that they found was a golden chariot wheel. All the other chariot wheels were dissolved, and the only thing that was left was coral. But this one was made out of gold. I think it was gold. And it was a four spoke, and they checked into history at that time, and that was the spokes that you would find on the pharaohs and on the princes of Egypt, that they would have those things. And they reburied it there because they were waiting for a time when they could pull it out and it could actually go to Israel. So, I mean, there's amazing things that that you can see there. But when you go across to where Mount Sinai is, you can see that where Mount Sinai is. You can see the tops of the mountains burned black. Remember the day when the Lord came down that there was fire and thunder and all these things? We're talking an oven up there with the fire of God blasting the mountains. It burned the mountains where you can see the area because of the blackness of what happened to the stones and the rocks. It's still there today, all these 3,500 years later. You talk about cooking a rock? I mean, he cooked it where even the rain didn't wash it all off after 3,500 years. So these things are there if we want to see. But see, the enemy's got, how many got a cell phone? Raise them up. How many got a smartphone? How many smartphones smarter than them? See, it's interesting to have all that information, but the enemy uses most of it, not all of it, but he uses most of it to eat up the moments and the hours of our day. Most of us spend more time on our smartphones than we do in our Word. Now, some of us will be in the Word on the smartphone, but if we really paid attention, we're probably spending more time on other things on the smartphone than the Word of God. See, the enemy knows you only have so many minutes and hours and days in your life, and he has to distract you so that you don't continue in the purpose of what God has placed you here for. Do you know God has a purpose for each and every one of us? Do you know his plan is so intricate that before you were born, before you took one breath, God numbered the days of your life and he wrote them down in a scroll? Do you know that there's a scroll in heaven of the things that God has ordained for you and for your family, for your children, what God has ordained for you to do? Do you know that? There's a destiny that God is waiting for. Do you know most people never fulfill that much of their destiny because the enemy is so busy keeping us busy doing other things? And you need to begin to ask God to show you what he would have you to do, because he created you very specific and placed you in the family, in the situation, as rough as it may have been, but he did it for a reason and a purpose and a plan, that he might bring forth fruit from the earth. And he wants to use you. And I want to stand before the Lord and say, Lord, I fulfilled what you called me to do. Jesus said that just before he was crucified. I fulfilled what you called me to do. I've revealed your name to them. I've revealed your character to them. I've let them know who you are and what you're all about. I got a boogie here. We're going to be here past the picnic. Moving on. I won't do that to you. He says that, so after this feast of Pentecost, and I was heading to Mount Sinai, because guess when Moses went up the mountain with and brought down the two tablets? It was on Shavuot. It was on the very first Pentecost. And that was not the day he came down. It was the day he went up. And he went up that mountain. But that was the day also that God audibly spoke to the children of Israel the Ten Commandments. And I think everyone went home and changed their underwear after God got done speaking to them. How do I know that? Because they went to Moses and said, tell him not to speak to us again. You go talk to him, and then you tell us what he's saying. See, God spoke to him, and they didn't want to hear from him because they were so afraid. And we won't go into all the reasons why the afraidness, but I'm telling you, it was God's purpose to have an intimate relationship with each one of them. Instead, they chose to set someone between them and God. Moses, you go talk to God. But God first talked to them, and they didn't want to hear. He brought them there as a marriage ceremony to connect them as a groom would to a bride. And they said, you talk to the best man, and he can tell me from now on what you want. What kind of a marriage is that where everything goes through the best man? Maybe he wasn't the best man. Maybe he was the only man that was available that was willing to do the things that God had called him to do. And he was a very spectacular person, went through all sorts of things. But what he brought us was shadows and types. But, you know, we can go through the kindergarten lessons, the shadows, and we can get so familiar with the kindergarten routine that we never want to grow up. I don't want to grow up. I'm a kindergarten kid. I like my naps. I like my snacks. Oh, it sounds like those older guys. Do you understand that picture? But we need to understand that the law came in a shadow. In fact, I'll just read it to you because I want to finish this. But in Hebrews, the third chapter, it says this. Let me just flip it to you. I think it's verse 5, if I've got it right in my memory here. But I want you to see. Aha, they didn't move Hebrews. I found him. It says, now Moses was faithful in all his house as a servant. Now, don't miss this next part. Moses was faithful in all of his house as a servant. And then he said, for a testimony of those things which were to be spoken later. What in the world does that mean? He was faithful as a servant, but he was faithful as a servant for a testimony of a message that would be spoken later. He said, there's something much greater than me coming. I'm giving you kindergarten lessons because you've been wild and footloose and been in slavery all this time and lied to from getting up to going to bed. But I'm going to teach you the principles, the basic principles, so that maybe you can start staying in the lines when you color. And then later he's going to want to let you go because he wants you to follow him by the Spirit. But anyways, I'm going to teach you these ABC things. You know, I was director of Teen Challenge for 10 years, and we had a regimen that we set our guys up, and our program was a year-long program. And we had a few of the people that had kept track with me after they came out, one in particular I can think of, and he went home. And he set up in his basement his study thing and set up a practice, and he started doing time-wise all the particular things we did at Teen Challenge because he never had structure. But does God want him to stay in all those particular things and at this time of the day that I do this and then at this time of the day that I do that? Does God want to keep us in that box? See, when I was in kindergarten, we used to take naps. We had our little rugs. They probably don't do that anymore. But you know, we'd lay down and take our naps and fight and fuss and do all that stuff. But when you come out of kindergarten, it's 1 o'clock. Let's all lay down and take our nap. Or it's 12:30 or whatever it is. Sometimes my wife starts early in church, right, hon? No, it's good. I'm in deep trouble again. I had to. Medications will do that to you. But you understand, when we grow up, we're not doing those things. And Moses spoke a message, a testimony of a message that would be spoken later. The problem is people won't let go of the kindergarten and grow up. They won't realize that there's something even greater coming. And he prophesied about that. Remember when he called, I think it was the 70 elders, and God was going to take the spirit that was on him and place on the 70, and there were some that were less in the camp, and they come to him and say, hey, there's these people left in the camp, and they're prophesying because they were supposed to go and they didn't. And they're all upset. What should we do to these people? They're not doing what they're supposed to do. We'll kill them, right? Like Moses? I'm tremendously paraphrasing. And he said, no, it says the Lord would that everyone would prophesy. What was Moses doing? He was prophesying about a new covenant that would come where there wouldn't just be a 70, but everybody would walk in that kind of relationship and that anointing. Do you understand? So even though they had a limited space where, I'm sorry, you can't do it because you're not one of the elders. You're not one of the 70. And when we stick and get caught up in all those rules, where are we? We're in kindergarten Christianity. And we're still using the big crayons. And God's got some fine points he wants to teach us. And the big crayons aren't going to get you there because it's going to obscure the fine points. And God wants us to grow up so that we can start using fine points. And we can understand the fine points instead of coloring on, you know, little kids when they color with the crayons that are as big as their arm. Some of them are. So God wants to show us those things. Let me finish this last feast. Do you understand that I'm just in the beginning of my message, so you know what kind of problem I have right now. I got to speed up quickly. And what is this last feast back in Exodus chapter 34 that he speaks to them about? Excuse me. Did I get it right? What is this last? Oh, I'm sorry. Wrong one. See, now I'm even in the wrong place. Exodus 23 is where we first started. Forgive me. So we've got the Feast of Harvest, which is known as Pentecost or Shavuot. And that was when Moses went up the mountain, and he's up there for 40 days. And he comes down. We're all familiar with the story of the golden calf and all of that stuff. We understand what went on there. But what most of us forget is that from when he came down from that mountain, he spent 40 days, he had them set up a tent. This wasn't the tabernacle in the wilderness, but they set up a tent that was outside of the camp, away from the people. And he spent the next 40 days fasting and interceding on behalf of Aaron and all the people, because God said, you can go to the promised land, I'll send an angel to lead you there, but I ain't going with you. And Moses said that if you don't go, don't take us from here. Most of us would say, hey, that's the prize. I'll take it. God, send us a letter, but we'll let you know how things are going in the promised land. But Moses was smart enough to know that without his presence, they had nothing. So he waited and didn't know. And at the end of 40 days, God speaks to him. And we'll get into that here in just a minute. And he goes back up the mountain. And he's up there another 40 days. And then he comes down. And we'll talk about that. That'll be kind of what we're going to close with today. But that's what happened at Mount Sinai. The next feast, and the other one here in the 23rd chapter of the book of Exodus, it says, verse 16 says, and you shall observe the Feast of Harvest, that's Pentecost, of the first fruits of your labors from what you've sown into the field. Now, these first fruits of their labors, this was when the wheat harvest was during Pentecost, 50 days after the first fruits. And then it says, also the feast of ingathering at the end of the year, when you gather in fruit from your labors in the fields. Now, we're not familiar with the term the feast of ingathering, but this group's another three feasts. It's called Yom Terah, the day of blowing, the feast of trumpets. There's like a multiple names for that day. And then 10 days later, we find the day of atonement or Yom Kippur. And then 5 days after that begins an 8-day feast, which is the feast of what? Of tabernacles, or Sukkot. Meaning booths or sukkahs, the huts that they lived in. And that's an important part. And we're going to try to get to that quickly. You can find more detail. I won't go there. I was going to earlier. But you can find more details on these three groups of feasts, because there's actually seven. There's actually eight. But there's... because most of us missed the first one. Remember, all these feasts were set up as kindergarten lessons, because God wanted to get them used to these appointed times. He wanted them all to gather in Jerusalem once they got into the promised land. They were all to gather before the Lord three times a year. We mentioned these three feasts. Why? Because God wanted to do something in them. And the enemy has come in, and he's taken this calendar away, and he said, oh, that's for the Jews. God didn't say, this is for you Jewish people. He says, these are my feasts. Do you serve a different God than the Jews do? If you do, Jesus isn't your Savior. You might think he is, but you got a golden calf Jesus, one of your own making. So he's the same God, and he says, if these are my feasts, show me in the Bible where he eliminated the feasts. I can take you to Colossians and talk about holding to the letter of those things, but that's more the shadow. Each one of these things speak of a bigger spiritual dimension. The first feast, even though they went through all these different things, Jesus walked through and fulfilled each one of the feasts. On the first one, on the Passover, unleavened bread, and first fruits, we just went through that. But guess what? He was the firstborn of many. Guess who else God wants to fulfill the Feast of Unleavened Bread? You and 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 me and everyone who will call by his name. Now, many, many churches understand being born again in Passover. You can say to somebody, happy first fruits. I did it in the Assembly of God Church that I grew up in. And most of the people looked at me, who are you and what are you saying? They had no idea what first fruits was, let alone unleavened bread, as far as a feast. And the enemy has taught us, see, this is the mixture, that all of these things are for the Jews and they're not for us. The Jews carried the kindergarten lesson because God says, Jesus said, I've got another flock that not of you, that's afar off. I'm adding to this, but I'm going to bring them in. Who's that other flock? Us Gentiles. And Ephesians 2 talks about that we were without hope in this world. And there were those that were near and those were far off, but we've all been brought close because of the blood of Jesus Christ. See, this feast needs to be fulfilled in us. We need to have that born-again experience. We need to realize that the death angel wants you. And he wants to destroy you. And we need the blood of Jesus Christ on the doorposts of our heart. We need to understand the unleavened bread. We need to get the mixture out of our life. What's mixture? The things that God didn't put in there. And we need to understand first fruits. What are first fruits? First fruits. If you have a first fruit, is there a second, third, fourth multiples? Absolutely, because they took the first sheath of the harvest, which meant there were tens of thousands, and if not millions of more sheaves that would be coming. Jesus was a first fruit, not a one of a kind, but the first of many. And we need to understand that he's our example. And as he walked on this earth, he wants you to walk on this earth. The authority that God gave him, he wants to give you, but he will only give it to you as you mature into sonship and you grow up and begin to understand and begin to get beyond the basic meanings of these feasts and get down to the details of what God wants to do in your life. He wants to take you beyond the big crayons and get you down to the fine point things so you're mature enough where you can begin to add and multiply and divide and deal with things and take care of things and righteously discern things. And Hebrews chapter 5 talks about that we've become to the point where we're able to discern good from evil. See, children don't need to discern good from evil. They need to know the rules. And the rules will protect them while they're growing up so they can begin to discern. But we can stick to the children rules. We can say, you can't cross that street because there's no crossing guard waiting there. And we're all sitting here. I sure hope God's going to send a crossing guard. And God says, I'm not. Grow up. Look both ways and don't get your hiney run over. You don't tell that to a 3-year-old, right? Because they're looking where they're headed and they're not paying attention to any interference in between, and they'll go bolting after a ball or whatever it is and not look left or right and pay attention if there's a car because of the lack of what? Maturity. So you and I need to begin to discern. Just like Hebrews 5 talks about. By now you ought to be teachers, but you need someone to teach you all over again the kindergarten lessons, because you should be able to discern good from evil because you've practiced and you've done that. And most of the church has been kept in a playpen. And you don't have to discern nothing because everything's laid out for you. That's what these world governments and what our government's trying to do. Is trying to make sure everything's laid out. You don't have to discern anything. You come, and when we say open your mouth, you say, and they'll put some food in there. And if it's time for you to die, they're going to cut off all your medicine, and you go die because you're of no value to us anymore. It's coming. You need to know that's coming. That wasn't a happy hallelujah. That was, you're right, it is. You got to discern some things with Gary here. He's... Oh, he said, yeah, that's how they behave. All right. Go with me. We got to keep moving. We're not going to get this done. Passover, Pentecost, and this final one, this Feast of Ingathering, is the harvest that we call We call it Sukkot. We call it the Feast of Booths. We call it what? The Feast of Tabernacles. So after Pentecost, I'm back with the children of Israel story. After Mount Sinai and all that, Moses comes down, the golden calf, and he waits before the Lord another 40 days. 40 days on the mountain, 40 days waiting in the tent of meeting, and then God sends him back up. Let's go to that part so I can begin to wind this up. Go with me to Deuteronomy chapter 10. And this is in other places, but there's some things in chapter 10 of Deuteronomy I want you to see. Now, Deuteronomy, the book of Deuteronomy, is at the end of the 40 years in the wilderness. Moses knows that they're about to cross over, and he knows he's not crossing over. And there's a new generation. Everyone that was 20 and older the first time that they decided that they couldn't go in because of unbelief. Won't go into that very deep. Everyone that was 20 and older, except for Joshua and Caleb, are now dead. And Moses. Moses is still alive. But Moses will be the last one of that generation that will die. And he'll die in the 34th chapter of the book of Deuteronomy, if you want to read that and see what happened. And they'll mourn him for 30 days. And then Joshua will begin the process of them crossing over. All right? And Joshua is a foreshadow of our Yeshua. We call it Joshua because we use a J, but there is no J in the Hebrew language. It's a Y. It's Yeshua, not Joshua, but Yeshua. So is it by chance that, by the way, Joshua or Yeshua that led them into the promised land, do you know he wasn't born with that name? Moses gave him that name. Oh, was Moses prophesying again? Absolutely, that there would be a Yeshua that would lead the body of Christ to cross over. And he would be the first that would go over. And he prepared a way for us. You see all the symbolism and things that were there, but the bigger picture is fulfillment. So here we've got Moses speaking to them, to this new generation. Many of them hadn't been born. Some of them were, you know, elementary school kids and teenagers and didn't have a clue what was going on other than dad said, pick up behind the camel when he does doo-doo in the camp. You know, that's about all they knew. But they've been through 40 years or portions of that 40 years in the wilderness. And now they're about to enter in. See, God had to wait for a new generation because the previous one wouldn't. You need to know that Jesus came to show us the way in. And God's been waiting for 50 generations for a company of people that will cross over into what God has for them. 50 generations. Dear Lord, let this be the generation. Let this old Caleb, this old crusty dog, that's what Caleb means. Let this old Caleb cross over with this next generation. I want to experience the promises of God. I want to walk into. We've seen people throughout history, individuals, or a small two or three, that have crossed over spiritually. And we've seen the might and the power and the signs and the wonders and the things of God manifested in their lives and in their ministries. And we've got books written about these people. We're excited about these people. But you need to know what's different between them and you is they crossed over and you and I haven't yet. And that crossing over, I kind of call it your graduation from kindergarten. You know how these kindergarten graduations? We need to graduate. And it's not as easy as you showed up for graduation. There's things that you've got to learn. And guess what? If you don't learn the lesson, you can spend the rest of your life in kindergarten. And that's where the church has been. In fact, Corinthians talks about that the children of Israel, they saw all this, but most of them were laid low in the wilderness, and that they are given as an example to us. So that we would believe and that we would press in and we wouldn't get caught up in the mess that they're in. I am winding this down. It's a slow wind, but I am winding it down. Deuteronomy chapter. So this is when, at the end of that second 40 days, Moses is in the tent of the meeting. God speaks to him, and he says, at that time, verse 1, the Lord said to me, cut out for yourself two tablets of stone like the former ones and come up to me on the mountain and make an ark of wood for yourself. So here's something that's different. The first time Moses goes up the mountain, he just sashays up there with his walking stick. And he leaves Joshua partway up the mountain. God cuts out two stone tablets and he writes the Ten Commandments on there. And he gives those to Moses the last day. He says, you need to go down there. There's a problem in the camp. All right? This time, after all of this mess, by the way, these people had vowed, they heard the Ten Commandments, yes, we'll do that. In 40 short days, they're doing what God told them not to do. Now, come on, let's be honest. You get born again, you say, God, I love you, I'm going to do all these things. And then guess what you find yourself doing? Am I the only one that's sinned more times than I want to count since I've been saved? I know the rest of you got it all down, right? We'll just change the rules and it's not sin anymore, right? God doesn't change the rules and he doesn't let the guilty go unpunished, right? So we need to stay in the blood. We need to stay under the blood. Well, they messed up in 40 short days. I'll guarantee you I did something wrong within 40 days of coming to the Lord. Might not have made it home that night without doing something I probably shouldn't have done. Why? Because I'm in such a habit and there's such a stronghold in our lives that we battle these things and the enemy says, see, you're no good. You'll never make it. You're bad seed. You're just not going to make it. Look at all those other people in church. They're doing great. Remember, we put our plastic face on? I'm doing great. And just before we got out of the car, we're fussing, fighting, kicking the kids, yelling at the wife. Wife's yelling at us. All right? So he's going back up the mountain, but this time God says, cut out for yourself. And I really believe it's a prophetic picture, not cut out for yourself, but cut out of yourself. This is the second circumcision. Joshua would do it in the flesh when they crossed into the promised land. But this is a picture of the second circumcision. And this is a cutting out of our stony heart that God says that he'll do. It's something that's done by God, but you've got to be willing. There's nobody that has a stony heart cut out that doesn't ask for it. And he says that he'll remove our heart of stone and give us a heart of flesh, and that he'll write his laws upon our heart, his ways, so that they become second nature. We don't have to read it and say, oh, I got to do this, and I got to do this, and I got to do this, because we're all going to know him. This is a picture. See, Moses was a servant, and he came as a testimony of a message that would be spoken. All of these things that he did are a testimony of your maturing in Christ. That's what these feasts are about. All of these feasts are about your maturing in Christ. Most of the church has not made it through the first feast, the Passover. That's where they're stuck. And if you don't grow up. I'm not saying you're going to hell. I'm just saying you're in awful danger. Is it easier to take a kid out or an adult if you're coming in to steal something? And if we remain children, it's easier for the enemy to take us out or to even to convince us to take ourselves out, right? So we need to grow up so that we're not so easily led astray. And when the enemy leads you astray, the path you're on is not to all sunshine and happiness. It's to bondage and destruction and utterly self-destruction. And that's what the enemy wants us to do. So that's why we've got to grow up. That's why we've got to get beyond the first feast. But if we don't understand these feasts and we don't understand Jesus fulfilled them, but he fulfilled them as an example to us of what he wants us to do, to grow up. See, every one of these feasts is a growing up pattern. The second feast, the feast of Pentecost or Shavuot, the first time Moses went up, he brought down these Ten Commandments on two stone tablets that God had cut out. And he brought down the teaching that God first spoke audibly, and they rejected hearing, not what he said, but hearing it from him. So he sent it down in stone because they didn't want ears to hear. Does that sound like Isaiah 6? That they'll hear but not hear, they'll see but not perceive, all these different things. And it's because of our choices. So God sends him up that mountain and he brings down his teaching in a written form. 2,000 years ago on Pentecost, he sent down the Holy Spirit. And where was the Holy Spirit or the Comforter to reside? In us. And the Bible tells us that the Holy Spirit is the teacher. See, the first time the shadow came, the teaching. But now he sent down the teacher to live in you. Do you want 10 things chiseled on a stone heart? I got to do this. I don't care what you say. This is what we're doing. But I can cross the street. I can tell the cars. Nope, you got to wait here. There's no crossing guard. Okay. Can we cross yet? Nope, no crossing guard. Dear God, send us a crossing guard. Come on, that's what's going on in most churches. And then we're mad at everybody because they're not following our rules because they didn't wait for the crossing guard. And the motivation behind waiting for the crossing guard is you don't want them hurt. But if we play that game forever, nobody grows up. And the people are so frustrated, they just leave the playpen. I'm done with you guys because if you're so stupid, you can't tell what's coming on the street. I'm not staying around anymore. And then they go back out there in the world and say, you know, scrap this Jesus stuff because I've had enough of this. These people are out to lunch. And that's going on all over the place. But this next one is that the teacher will come down at Pentecost and dwell within us. Most of the church world has not come to that conclusion. So here all's they're left with, that the teacher isn't living within them, and they're not looking to him, the Holy Spirit speaking to them. They're stuck with waiting for people to tell the crossing guard to tell them when to cross the street. And God wants us to be able to discern. And you're not going to be able to discern if you got to wait for a crossing guard. You'll always be dependent on the pastor or somebody else to bring it for you or to take your prayers to God or whatever. So because you haven't grown up. And a lot of organizations like it that way because we can keep you dependent on us. It's kind of like our government. They want to keep you dependent on them so you'll keep voting for them and they'll keep giving you your food and they'll keep giving you this and they'll keep giving you that. But God wants us to grow up as he wants our nation to grow up and understand that we can stand and we can make decisions and we can determine when it's time to eat and when it's not time to eat. I'm really getting political here. Am I in trouble? I live there. It's all right. But do you see that picture? Every one of these feasts are about your and my maturity in Christ. So we're sitting here and most of the progressive is not the right word, but most of the spiritual church is stuck at Pentecost. Oh, there's another set of feasts, but we're not interested in that because we're still dealing with the two golden calves of Easter and Christmas. Did I just say that? Yes, I did. I can say that about Christmas. It's my birthday, not Jesus. He wasn't born on Christmas. Do you understand that Christmas this year will be the first day of what? Hanukkah. It actually hits exactly on the same day. It's a rarity that it does that. So my birthday this year will be the first day of Hanukkah. It's believed if you run from Hanukkah to the last feast of Tabernacles, guess how many weeks it is? 40. Ladies, what's 40 weeks mean to a woman? It gets a belly, it kind of looks a lot like mine. That's the full gestation period of a child. It is truly believed that during the feast of Hanukkah is when Jesus was conceived. Why? Because he was born during Tabernacles. 40 weeks later. There's so many things we don't know because we don't know God's calendar. And the enemy says, you don't need it. That's for them Jews over there. They're all out to lunch, right? No, they're not. And I thank God because they've held all of these principles, at least the kindergarten principles they've held for us. But we've got to grow up so we can help them grow up. So they can get out of kindergarten. And they can get to Pentecost or Shavuot and have the teacher come and dwell in them and not be caught having to sing, oh, I got to build another temple so we can sacrifice some more animals. See, they even got to Passover. They don't understand the Passover lamb had already been there 2 millennia ago. And that's why they're looking to build another temple. God's going to build a temple. But these are the lively stones that he's building his temple that will end up being a permanent habitation for the Spirit of God. And that's what brings us to this next feast. See, Moses went back up on that mountain in the 10th chapter of Deuteronomy, and the day he stepped up that mountain, guess what day that was? That was last Sunday on God's calendar, the first day of the sixth month. And he would go up that mountain and he'd come down 40 days later. But 40 days from last Sunday is Yom Kippur, the Day of Atonement. It's the highest holy day. And they turned the Jewish teaching in the kindergarten lesson, turned that into every year that they spend this 40 days in preparation and cleansing their lives so that they would be prepared to see whether or not God was going to forgive their sins for another year. And I'm telling you, there's revelation here. We talked about it on our, by the way, we started Sunday night and we've been meeting most every night. Today we're going to do it as I close today. But we've been blowing the shofars and we've been meeting and interceding and we've been asking God to bring us revelation about all these different things. So you're welcome to join us. We'll meet here, not tonight because we're doing it this morning, but tomorrow night, Tuesday night, Wednesday night, Thursday night, Friday, we'll do it during the burn. We'll be here Saturday night, and we're doing it every day of the week, okay? So you're welcome to do that, 7 o'clock to 8-ish, we'll shut her down and stay in. Talk and do questions and things if you can't stay that long. If you feel led, you want to pray. But see, these are times of maturing and growing. There has never been a company of people that have stepped into tabernacles. Never been. There's been individuals that have stepped into it. But they were ahead of their time, but they were ahead of the people because the people wouldn't cross over. And there were individuals, just like the Joshuas and Calebs, during their generation of all those millions of Jews, there were two that stepped in. And every generation, there's a scattering of people that will step into this tabernacles thing. And many theologians teach this tabernacles is about the millennium, and that's hogwash. That's because they hadn't come out of the kindergarten lesson. They haven't even got to the next one. I'm telling you, there's something there. Do I have all the answers? No, I don't. But I'm telling you, there's answers that are coming. In fact, I'm going to read just real quickly here because I don't even know. I better look at my phone, see if it's tomorrow. Is it tomorrow yet? All right, I got a few minutes. All right. Let's read this so I can get us where we're going. So cut out for yourself two tablets of stone like the former ones and come up to me on the mountain. And the next part says, make an ark of wood for yourself. First time God tells, what's this ark of wood going to end up being? It will end up being the Ark of the Covenant after he comes back down. And they'll overlay it with gold. It'll be placed in the holiest of holies, and only the high priest is able to see it once a year. Guess what that is a shadow of? It said, make an ark of what? Is wood from heaven or from earth? It grows out of the earth. What are you made of? Out of the earth in these physical bodies. And if you read that in the Hebrew, it says make for yourself an ark. It says make yourself an ark. That's right. Do you understand that's what this tabernacles is all about? Are you willing to make yourself an ark where God can deposit his holy word inside of you? And then the next part, he wants to overlay you with gold. He wants to top you off with the mercy of God and the mercy seat of God. He wants angels attending and watching over. Doesn't the scripture talk about angels? That their mission is to attend those who are heirs of salvation. Do you see the shadow of this mercy seat? And inside they also placed a golden jar of manna that would come later. Revelations talks about that jar of manna, that hidden manna. Do you understand what God wants to do? He wants you to be the ark that carries the presence of God wherever you go. That's what tabernacles is all about. And the first tabernacles, they would end up in the wilderness. And he tells them to, at tabernacles, they would build these sukkahs, or these little huts. And for a whole week in Israel and different places, they'll live in these huts. And they say it's to remind them when they were in tents in the wilderness. Well, that's nice. I mean, you can tell me. I don't need to go build a hut to do that. But it's a kindergarten show and tell lesson. And the part that they're missing is they lived in tents in the wilderness. But for the first time since the Garden of Eden, somebody else lived with them. And who was that? Was the Lord in the tabernacle of meeting. God came down and tabernacled in an earthly tent and walked among the people. That's what tabernacles is all about. And God wants to come down and he wants to tabernacle in you. That's what the Feast of Tabernacles is about. That's one of Jesus' names. Remember I told you he was born at Tabernacles? If we had the time, I could prove it to you. But I'm telling you, he was born at Tabernacles. Not in December. That's Baal worship, and that's where they get those holidays from. Jesus, one of his names is Emmanuel, God with us. He was a first fruit. God wants to be with and in you. God desires to tabernacle in a people, but that a people that will grow up and mature where he can deposit. It's called the adoption as sons. And it's a maturing point where he can place his glory and his anointing into a group of people. And by the way, that feast goes on for 8 days, and 8 means new beginnings. There's a new beginning that God wants to bring a company of people into. Do you want that? Then spend the rest of these 33 days of the 40 days. Today's the 8 days, so we get today and then 32 more. As we press on for this. And there's more revelation. I'm waiting on God. There's more revelation on the Day of Atonement. Most of the Jewish people believe that the Passover is a picture of an individual getting saved. And they believe that the Day of Atonement is the day that all of Israel will be saved. And I think they have it wrong, but they have it partially right. Because I think the Day of Atonement is when a company of people, the true Israel of God, I'm not talking about replacement theology. I'm talking about when a true company of people will stand up as Israel. See, Israel wasn't Israel until he struggled and wrestled with God, and God changed his name. And you're not going to, God is not going to tabernacle in you and I until we struggle and wrestle. Jacob was a rascal, and he had all kinds of issues and problems, and he spent a lot of years dealing with those problems. Sound familiar? And God brought him through that process. And before he crossed over, he won victory with man and victory with God. That's a picture of what needs to happen with us so that God can say, I can trust them. I'll come and I'll dwell in them. John G. Lake spoke of this process, happened in his life. He had been born again, spirit-filled. He was in the ministry. He was healing, miracles, signs, and wonders. And my paraphrase, not his, but there's got to be more. And he pressed into God. And the only way he could describe the next phase of what happened to his life, because I don't think he understood the fullness of the tabernacles. We don't yet either. But I'm telling you, I've got the outline of it, and that's what I'm sharing with you today. But John G. Lake, he said, the only thing I can describe is that God stepped into me, and he referred to himself as the God-man. Catherine Coleman speaks of a similar thing. She says, I can show you the place where I died. Have we really died? Or have we been hauling Jesus along to kind of help with our deal? Or are we dead to our deal and alive to his? There's so much here, and I could keep you all afternoon, and as tempting as that is, I won't do that. But I'm telling you, pray, intercede. There is something about this tabernacles, and I really believe this could be the tabernacles where a company of people break through, and we begin to see it happen. And we begin to see, we look at the world around us, and I could take you to scriptures that prophesy out of Isaiah, that prophesy about darkness and deep darkness on the people, and talk about the glory of the Lord. I was looking for a verse, and I didn't have time to go back and find it. But basically, Jesus is telling the Father, the glory that you've given me, I've given them. That's speaking about tabernacles. I want to close with this. Dale brought it up, I think it was last night, Dale, if I can remember. And I want you to turn with me. There's more here, but I'm not going to run through all the details. But turn with me to Luke in the 9th chapter, and we'll close with this today. This is a revelation that the Lord gave Dale. Thank you, Dale. I got to find a Kleenex, just a minute. All right. Oh, man. Didn't wipe my eyes. Now I can't see. I can see. Just not like that. Luke, the ninth chapter. And it says this, beginning in verse 27. And he says, but I say to you truthfully, there are some of those standing here who will not taste death until they see the kingdom of God. And immediately the next verse, it says, in verse 28 of chapter 9, it says, some 8 days after these. How many days? What does eight represent again? How many days are the Feast of Tabernacles? My goodness, could there be something here? Dale says yes. I say yes. I say that was from heaven. Some 8 days later, after he says that, it says he took along Peter, John, and James and went up the mountain to pray. And while he was praying, the appearance of his face became different and his clothing became white and gleaming. And behold, two men were talking with him, and they were Moses and Elijah, who appearing in what? In glory. Were speaking of his departure, which was about to be accomplished at Jerusalem. Now, Peter and his companions had been overcome with sleep. Does that sound like the condition of the modern church? See, the Lord tells us to rest, but the enemy says, go to sleep. I got to meddle with this. 7 days, or 6 days, God created the heavens and the earth. And on the seventh day, he what? Was he tired? Poor God. He wore himself out in 6 days. He must not have been quite all-powerful at that time, huh? So when it says he rested, it wasn't he was tired and needed a nap. He had finished the work. The word is better described as the artisan putting down his chisel and saying it's perfect. Was better described as the painter putting the brush down and said there's nothing more that needs to happen to this Mona Lisa. And God put it all into motion. Gary, you had something?
Yeah. He was getting ready for Monday.
I asked, am I going to regret this? I said, yeah. I should have looked at Linda's eyes before I handed him the mic. Usually he's got really good stuff. Sometimes we got the ha-has, which are okay too. But it says they'd all been overcome with sleep, but when they were fully awake, that is a synonym to growing up and maturing in Christ, being able to see, being able to hear, being able to discern good from evil. They were fully awake. That is what God is trying to do in your life and mine. But when they were fully awake, what changed? They saw his glory. And the two men standing with him. And these two men, Moses and Elijah, represent the law and the prophets. And they understood when they were fully awake and they saw through his glory, they understood that what he was doing was what both of them had been prophesying about all along. See, they've been testifying about he who was to come and what he would do and what he would say. And when they were fully awake, it was then when they saw his glory. God wants us to wake up. Matthew chapter 25 talks about the 10 virgins. They'd all fallen asleep. And then the shout went out, behold the bridegroom. Come out to meet him. Come out of your bedchambers. Come out of your kindergarten classes. We need to come out. We need to come out of that system in the world, and we need to wake up to what God has. And look at this. This is really, really interesting. And it says this, and he saw the two men standing with him. Verse 33, and as these were leaving him, Peter says to Jesus, Master, it is good for us to be here. Let us make three what? Did he really say tabernacles? One for you and for Moses and for Elijah, not realizing what he was saying. So here's Peter saying, let's make three sukkahs. Let's make three tabernacles. What made him think of tabernacles? The glory of God. But it says he didn't realize what he was saying. He was prophetically speaking and had no understanding about what he was talking about. But he was speaking for who? For you and I. Do you understand the glories about tabernacles? I won't go back there. You get a chance, read it, chapter 10 of Deuteronomy. Moses goes back up the mountain. God writes on the tablets that he cut out of himself. Can I say it that way? And then he placed them in the ark. Jeremiah 31, 31, a new covenant. I'll write my laws on your hearts and everyone will know me. There's so much, so many scriptures that deal with this. But Moses comes down the mountain the second time. He comes down on the Day of Atonement. And the children of Israel are still down there in the camp because they don't know if they're going to live or die. They just saw 3,000 80 days before killed in the camp, and Moses destroyed the golden calf. And then he finally goes back up the mountain, and they see the fire and all this stuff going up. See, the mountain got burned twice for 40 days. Can you imagine putting a blowtorch on a mountain for 40 days twice? That's what God did, because he's an all-consuming fire. And yet Moses stepped in there kind of like Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, and he came down being unscathed by the flame and the fire of God. And why is he consuming fire? Because he consumes everything that's not true, everything that's not of him, all the mixture, all the leaven, all the lies of men. The closer you get to him, he consumes all the false things that are in us. He says, no man can see me and live. God's plan is to kill you and bring forth the new you that's purified in the fire. And that's what this is about. That's what this season is, as we press in the next 40 days. So anyone who wants to join me, I'm going to close here with blowing of the shofars. And what we've been doing, it was a word the Lord had given Linda. And you say, well, you know, that's silly. Why blow shofars? Well, they said that to Joshua when he walked around Jericho for 7 days and the priests were blowing the trumpets every 7 days. And the last day when they finally blew them, the people shouted and the walls came down flat. They didn't tip over. They went down like an elevator. Because these walls were so wide, they used to have chariot races up on the top of them. And if you push a wall that wide over, it's laying on its side almost as tall as it was when it was standing up. So if you knock it into a pile of rubble, you're still going up two-thirds of the same height to try to get over it. But it says everyone went straight way in. How do you go straight way in unless something goes down? God miraculously brought down all the wall but one small area. It was the house of Rahab the harlot. Had the thread hanging out. And there's so much in that scripture. There's so many things there. And we sound the trumpets. You know that God's angels are ministering to those that will inherit salvation? And they follow God's word. And as we line up with God's word and begin to declare God's word, these ministering angels are going to begin to step in and do things. You're not commanding them. God is commanding them. But as you line up with God's word and begin to declare it, guess what we're going to begin to see happen? And they're waiting for assignments. They're waiting to fulfill assignments. They're waiting for a people that will declare on earth as it is in heaven. Do you understand? That your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Who declares it on earth? Man, because God gave the earth into the hands of man. There's so much here. You can stay there or come up. Anybody else wants to blow? But what we're going to do is we close tonight. Or today. Tonight. Is it tonight yet? Can I keep going? I'll quit. We're going to blow 3 blasts to the north, to the south, to the east, and the west. And that represents 12, and we just felt that that was the right number. But we're going to do that in closing. So if you'd stand with me, and we're going to go.
When the Lord spoke to me, he spoke to me at 8 o'clock in the morning, and he said, I want to hear the sound of the shofars at Gateway for 40 days. And then he said, I want my name lifted up, one of my names lifted up every day. And so this is what we have done. The name of the Lord that we will honor today is my song. In Hebrew, it's Zimrati. Exodus 15:2. Yah is my strength and my song, and he has become my salvation. This is my God. I will glorify him. My Father's God. I will exalt him. Psalm 40, verse 4. He put a new song in my mouth. A song of praise to our God. Many will look on in awe and put their trust in Adonai. Psalm 96, 1 through 3. Sing to Adonai a new song. Sing to Adonai all the earth. Sing to Adonai. Bless his name. Proclaim his victory day after day. Declare his glory among the nations, his wonders among all peoples. And we will do that. And finally, Psalm 149, 1. Hallelujah. Sing to Adonai a new song, his praise in the assembly of the faithful. And when I read this last part, he said, we are an assembly of the faithful. And you know, when the Lord speaks to us, when he speaks to us, sometimes he says things that really kind of just like shock us, really surprise us. Well, that's wonderful. And he told me right before Tom finished, he said, we are an assembly of the faithful. That is who we are. We will cross over. We will make that change. And then he said, from now on, we would be known to him as Jeshurun, or in Hebrew, it's Yeshurun, and it means dear, upright people. That is from the Lord. That is what he thinks of us. He knows us better than we do, and he knows what we will do. How wonderful it is to know that he knows the end from the beginning. Baruch Hashem Adonai, blessed be the name of the Lord. Hallelujah.
As we blow these, that will be the closing. As we blow the shofars here, then we're going to close with that. But God bless you. If you can make it, and the picnic is at 5. Okay. And they got directions that he mentioned. They're probably on the other side there. You got address for them. All right. We'll bless you. We can blow the silver trumpets. Yeah, we can do that. Somebody else want to blow a silver trumpet? We got two of them up here. Kelly, can you blow one? Or would you rather blow a shofar? Be instant, in season, and out. God bless you.